I started Lenny McKinley in 1968, and when in 71 I was a senior, 17 going on 18 years of age.
And then can you just state your name?
My name is Donald Vassar.
Awesome. So where are you from? And can you talk a little bit about your journey on the way to being a high school student in Columbus at Lenny McKinley?
I was born in Birmingham, Alabama. In the 50s. I'm not going to tell you what year, but in the 50s. I was born in Birmingham, Alabama. In a city called Pratt City. And if you know anything about Pratt City, it is the birthplace of Fred Shuttleworth, one of the architects of the Civil Rights Movement with Martin Luther King. And it was part of Birmingham. I was born not too far from his church. Yes. And we moved to York, Alabama. Which is not too far from Meridian, Mississippi, where the three Freedom Riders got killed. Goodman, Cheney, and Swarner. I think those were the three names. It's probably about 20 miles from them. Okay, and then we moved up north to Peoria, Illinois, living in a project called Taft City, Taft Projects. And from there, we came to Columbus, Ohio. At Taft City, one of the things that impressed me was that we had a little corner store that was serving the project. And one of the ladies who was an NAACP representative lived in the project. She put a strike on that store because they didn't hire any black people. And this was in the early 60s. And we did not support the store until they hired a black person out of the project. And also, her son told me years ago, who was my best friend, that he was at Dr. King's I Had a Dream speech in Washington, D.C. So they went down there that year to see the speech. And these people are the people who kind of impressed me with their desire to do things. And then I moved to Columbus, Ohio in the early 60s. And been here pretty much ever since, except for a few years out of the States. Mm-hmm. Is there anything else?
No, that's great. That's mm-hmm. great. So you were exposed to
racism
and racism and activism against it at a really early age.
Jim Crow. Oh, let me go on back. I was, even as a young man, as a young person, consciousness in the South, Jim Crow laws, they was taught two things. When you see a white lady get off the sidewalk, we was taught that at a very early age. You don't look a white man in the eye. Those are things that were taught to us when we was in Alabama. And that was a survival tactics, because if you didn't, you possibly could get lynched. And those are the things that were taught to you at an early age. And I remember being taught that. You move out of the sidewalk, if a white lady walk down the street, if you're on the same sidewalk with her, and you do not look a white person in the eye. These are things that were taught to us.
Wow. Okay, so that's deep. So then as a young person,
it was a survival. It was a survival tactics. Hold on one second. Okay. I can't hear you.
Can you turn it off or mute it?
Yeah, mute it. I give it to my friend.
Oh, okay. But your friend is outside the room?
No, he's on the other side of the room.
Okay, can you make sure the volume is off? Because if it happens again, we'll lose the whole shot.
Okay, let me turn it off.
They traveled together, so we were able to change the rules a bit for them. Generally, the second person would be in a separate closed booth, but because they traveled together, we're able to make concession. And at the end, so you will have to consider, we can go right into the next interview after a short break if you'd like. We can even use the same link.
Okay, I turned it off.
Yeah. Okay, great. Thank you. Mm. Okay, thanks, Al. Thank you, Mr. Vassar. Mm. And just so you know, when I'm asking you the questions, the reason why I'm not saying anything and I'm muting myself is so that your sound is clean, because if we get our voices overlapping, then we won't be able to use it. So
okay.
I want to hear from you and just be able to use everything that you say.
Okay.
So if I'm being kind of weird, that's why.
It doesn't seem weird to me. or been in all situations. So, okay, go on.
So then, as an older young person, by the time you got to be, you know, a teen or so, what was your awareness of the political and social turmoil that was happening in the country? So say by the time you got to be to high school, and what of all of the events or the happenings that you recall, what affected you the most?
Well, one of the things that affected me was the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King. That happened in junior high when I was in junior high school. And I also remember the vice principal giving us an assembly about it and how he was crying and everything. And then I started reading about Dr. Martin Luther King and what he was trying to accomplish and so forth and things like that. And for him to be assassinated, it was pretty devastating. Those are the things I remember. And after that, you know, I started realizing that African Americans have a lot to contribute to American society. As I call it, African American, back then we called ourselves black. It was calling us Negroes and colored. So we started calling ourselves black to counteract that. And then we started wearing the afros and stuff like that, which my parents did not like at first. My parents didn't like it at first. Why are you guys wearing your afro? But it was just a rebellion statement saying that this is us. This is where we are. Why should we be cutting our hair short? Why should we be ashamed of ourselves? This is how our hair naturally grow. This is what we are. These are what we are. So, I mean, what we are, and we should not be afraid of that, or ashamed of it.
And so, even when the assassination happened or other things happened, were you looking at the news, and what were your thoughts when you would see these things and see, you know, the demonstrators being hosed or dogs?
That's pretty upsetting. Matter of fact, you know, I was aware of this, conscious of this stuff. I was telling people back in Illinois, I was conscious. I had an African-American teacher, and she was the one that brought it to my attention, racism and stuff like that. You know, we didn't have a name for it back then, and segregation and stuff like that. She was the one that brought it to my attention in our classroom. And when I moved to Ohio, it was still going on. The Freedom Riders, like I say, Cheney, Goodman, and Schwarner, the three people that got killed in Meridian, Mississippi, I was aware of that. Because it wasn't too far from where my grandmother lived. I was aware of Representative Lewis and his travels and so forth. All of that, I was aware of that. It wasn't a day in my life I was not aware of this kind of stuff. I mean, as far as consciousness when I got older. I mean, probably past 4 years old, I wasn't aware of it.
Okay. Thank you. So then, when you were in the Linden community, and how old were you when you moved to Linden?
10.
You could start by saying that, but then also, can you talk about what the community was like when you were there, when you were a high school student, and did you feel racial tension?
Well, when I first went to Linden McKinley, when we first moved up to Linden area, I was in elementary school. I went to elementary school there. I went to junior high school, and then when we got to Linden, there was little things of segregation, I mean, not segregation, but systemic racism that was still there. That's what you guys call it at this time. Such as I went out for sports and we played football, and one of the coaches made sure that it wasn't predominantly a black team. What he would do would have one person be black and one other person would be white. And that's how he divided it up the team. Even if you were better than a person, he still had a white person or a black person on the team. I mean, a different position. Like, I played offensive and defensive end. One guy was white and one guy was black. It was always like that. When we started up at Linden McKinley was predominantly a white school. And by the time I think it was our junior year, it was a 50-50. And I think by the time it was a senior year, it was more black than it was white. And it changed. But some of the teachers, you know, they held their old ways and stuff, you know, and they looked at us as students, but, you know, what could we accomplish once we got out of school? Their job was there just to teach.
So let me ask you, did you feel, when you were at the school, did you feel question with, you know, with that change that you just talked about and the change in the community in terms of demographics, did you feel that tension at the school?
Technically, I'm going to tell you the truth. We didn't do that. I didn't feel anything like that at that point in time. And it got, but after the first few years, it was something we just accepted. Then our senior year, when we became majority, we decided, hey, we started taking Black history classes. We started learning things about our history. But me, I had been reading about Black history for years, ever since I was in junior high school before that. But I started reading more and more and more and more. I learned about Black history, the more I was amazed at the things that Black people had accomplished here in America. And I was always wondering why this wasn't part of our history lessons. And also I started learning about stuff that we had accomplished way before we even got here to America, African American and Black people. And I started wondering why wasn't this taught to us? Why wasn't we aware of these things? And that's one of the things why we started a Black Student Union at Lyndon McKinley. We want a curricula that encouraged this kind of talk, encouraged this type of thinking, instead of us always being shuffling and yes sir and no ma'am and all this other stuff. We wanted something that was something positive. One of the people I idolized when I was a kid was Muhammad Ali, because of his way he spoke, way he stood up to people, where he said, this is my name. These are the people I idolize. I used to always write his name on my papers and stuff like that when I was in elementary school, because I wanted people to stand up and talk to these people. Because I can remember an incident in the South when me and my mother and my aunt was driving down the street, and a caravan of Ku Klux Klan came by, and they pulled off to the side of the road and cut their lights off, afraid of the Klan, and I couldn't figure out why they were afraid. And that's what they did. And I said, I would never fear a man in my life. And I always liked the people who would show some kind of, you know, moxie as the time sign.
Right, and so I'm curious then, as you got older and you became a man, did you, when you think about those experiences and your family pulling up to the side and turning the lights off, do you have a different perspective? Do you have more understanding for why they did what they
did? Yeah, I understand it now. It was a life-saving thing. It was life-saving. Perhaps if they didn't, how do you know they wouldn't have surrounded of us and did a lynching? You know, we don't know. And this was a survival tactic. And so, therefore, I understand what they were doing. They wanted us to live.
Gotcha. So with these feelings that you had and these sensibilities that you had, you were a part of a group of your classmates who met regularly. That's the Black Student Union you're referring to?
Yeah, we started a Black Student Union. It was a few of us. I don't know how it took place, but I remember the date. But we were just walking, and we started together. We started talking, and, hey, let's start as a Black Student Union. Let's do something that's... And the purpose of initially when it was started was just to get a curriculum in there so that we can understand what we did. Like I told you at first, Black people have done a lot to America. I mean, a lot for America. They accomplished a lot, even though we had a harder task than everybody else. We came over as slaves, and we had to come from slavery to get where we were at. But a lot of stuff we didn't even know. I never heard about the Oklahoma. Burning down the Wall Streets and I think in Oklahoma, stuff like that. We never heard about that kind of stuff. Stuff that they taught us about was Booker T. Washington and people like that. And we didn't hear about the people who were the Nat Turners and things like that till later on in life.
So you're a Black Student Union, you all met at John Wells' house and I guess at Al Young's house?
We had met at various people houses. It was more than them also. We met at various people lot. We was trying to put a curriculum together. We wanted to come up with an idea of what we wanted the school to implement. You know, something that was positive. We were at Lyndon McKinley and the halls was filled with, you know, pictures of prior people who were 100% white on the walls. We wanted pictures of stuff like Malcolm X and Dr. Martin Luther King and people like that, do something, show some positive inspiration for black kids. And that's what one of the things we want. The curriculum teaches about black history. Why are we just now learning about this stuff until we start taking black history? Some of the stuff we didn't even know about. We was unaware of the things that the accomplishment that African Americans have done here in the United States and worldwide. We was unaware of it. We just wanted something positive.
So then that was definitely a big part of the group's goals. Mm-hmm. Did you also feel that you were treated unfairly at the school, or by the administration?
Each one of us got a different perspective. Each student at Lynn McKinley have different perspectives and different thoughts. Me, I couldn't say yes. I couldn't say the teacher is indifferent. It was just a school.
Okay. So when you were meeting at this black student meeting, when you guys were meeting, first of all, who were some of the kids that were part of the student union and what were they like? And then can you also talk a little bit about what your role was in the group and how you and John Wells were different?
Well, the student union, we had a plethora of people. We started off with a group of people, then we would eliminate people and we would continue going. We started off, I think it was John Whitaker, myself, Don Ballore, John Wells, Harrington, we had Brenda Johnson, we had her brother, I don't know his name,
Ricky
Johnson. We had a few other people, Valor Washington and us. We all met at different places and we started coming up with, trying to come up with a curriculum, which we was gonna, not a curriculum, but ideas of what we wanted to do as far as how we were gonna present it to the teachers and so forth. This is what we wanted. And as time went along, some people dropped out and some came in. And that's when Al Young started coming in afterwards. He wasn't there initially with us, but he came in later on with us. But John Wells, myself, Whitaker, Brendan Johnson, John Harrington, and I think we were the original people who started it. And my role in it, we really didn't have no role. But certain people just take on natural role. John Wells was bombastic. He was loud. He was out front. John Whitaker was intellectual, thought and everything. Myself, I was more like probably the sergeant arm. I had a little tough man reputation in there. So, but I wasn't as whoa, you went off the screen. Hello?
I'm still here. I have to get off camera for a second, but I can still hear you and I'm still here with
okay.
you. So go ahead and continue. I'm sorry about the interruption.
Yeah, and Wells probably wanted to be like H. Rap Brown and Stokely Carmichael, the real loud and aggressive people. And mine was more like, let's see what's going on. I mean, I'm not ready to burn America down. I'm not ready to destroy, this America. John Wells was a little different, but he also had different issues. And Whitaker was more, like I said, the intellectual, the guy that kept us calm and everything. And we had different meetings and so forth and so forth. And we was going
to... Do you recall Valora Washington? Can you speak to her a little bit?
Yeah, I know her real good, Valora Washington. She was pretty articulate back then. She spoke, and she said a lot of things. She started off with us, probably the second meeting or something like that, but later on, I don't know what happened. She sort of dropped out.
I see. So I want to talk a little bit about some of the people who were around you at the school, and I wonder if you could talk about how the presence of Gary Davis, Bruce Bunch, and Tom Brown affected black students at the school.
Well, Gary Davis was, I took black history classes from him. Gary Davis was informing. He informed us about a lot of things that we weren't aware of. We wasn't aware. He told us about the He told us about situations in Africa where the white slave traders came over and gave the Africans blankets and stuff like that, and they had smallpox on them, pretty much wiped them out, stuff like that. He told us about histories and different types of things that had happened in American history. Bruce Bunch, I really don't know him that well because I didn't take a class. From the only thing I did, I saw him at school. Mr. Brown, he and I had a run in a couple of times, so I can't say nothing. I don't want to say nothing bad, but we had a run in. I wore my hat one day to school, and he told me to take my hat off, and I didn't want to take my hat off because I didn't want to be bowing and stuff like that. And he told me, hey, if you don't take the hat off, you're out of here or something like that. So I just leave that there. I didn't take my hat off. So I think he was there initially to be an enforcer. And then after he got to knowing us and what we stood for, he started sympathizing with us. And that's what I think. It was a change in him, too.
Did you feel that the three of them were, in general, were a supportive presence? Do you think your experience at the school for those 4 years would have been different?
3 years. We went to school 3 years. 3 years. Okay.
3 years.
They inspired us, especially Mr. Davis, from my standpoint. See, I knew him more than the other ones. He inspired us. I mean, led us on tracks. I did a lot of reading. Most of my reading, I read a whole bunch of books about black history. King, the critical biography, Martin Luther King. I wrote Malcolm X books. I wrote Soul Dad by George Jackson. I wrote one of my best books with Claude Brown, Man, Child, and Promised Land, and stuff, sent Heron in New York and how it destroyed New York and stuff like that. I read A Wasp. I read any kind of book that had anything with a black author. I read about Muhammad Ali, all those books. So I was constantly reading books about black histories and stuff like that, even A. Phil Randolph and Booker T. Washington. I read books about them too. Anything had anything to do with African-American people or black as we were called at that time. And I read about them. And I tried to keep my mind up on all the issues. Even Huey Newton, I read his books, To Die for the People and all this other stuff. And Bobby Seale and all of them guys, I knew all of them. I had read something about them, checked on them. And that's what influenced me, was their stories.
Would you say that having the benefit of reading those books, did that change how you move through the world?
Yeah, absolutely. It gave me confidence. He understood that it was going to be a struggle. Understood that it wasn't going to be given to me, that you was going to have to struggle for it. And sometimes you might have to make a sacrifice. Because all them guys I'm talking to, most of them have made some kind of sacrifice. Most of them either end up dead or shot or killed or something.
Okay, so let's go to 1971. And I wonder if you could describe what happened at the Black History Week performance, the play that was performed in the auditorium. And if you could just start from the beginning and tell us what role was in that.
Okay, this is my perspective of it. Gary Davis was presenting a Black History play. And it was in 1970, Richard Nixon made February Black History Month. So this was the following year, 1971. And I was taking a black history class with Gary Davis, and he decided, hey, he was going to put on a stage play that showed our, from Africa to America, the journey that black people had made. And I was chosen as to be the king of the play. So I was on stage. And my role was to have dancers around me. I was going to sell a few slaves to the slavers, as I'm going to call them. And eventually, they was going to come back and capture me and take me to America. And this is one of the things that the play was going to end up doing. So I was sitting on the stage, and as I was watching the stage, I was sitting on, they had made a makeshift crown. I was sitting up there watching the play and everything, and people were dancing around me, and I was just getting ready to, Slave Owner was supposed to come out and make a deal for me, for these new slaves, and just as I was doing that, paper came over the balcony. So I was there watching as it came over the balcony. And I seen somebody run out, and people, I thought people were chasing him, but from my perspective, it could have not have been. And later on, I learned that it was a guy who went to school with us named Rick Warren. Actually, he played football with us. And anything else?
So you knew him, you knew Rick Warren. Did you know any of the others who were involved with dumping the flyers?
We knew Rick Warren because we found out who it was. But we also know that Rick had a car out there waiting on him. And when he jumped in the car, somebody pulled off. But me being inside on the stage, I did not see this.
So once that happened, what was going on in the auditorium?
We had a play, and people was looking around trying to figure out what was going on, why this particular play. This is the first time we ever had a play at our school on Black history, and for people to dump paper on the stadium, on the people like that, it was disrespectful. That was what the term is nowadays, disrespectful.
Did you happen to see one of the flyers? Did you get to read what was on the
No, board? I didn't actually have seen his flyers. I was sitting out there trying to figure out what was going on. Why is these papers coming over, you know, over the stadium, what they were seeing. No, I didn't see any.
Did you find out later did anyone tell you what was on them?
Yes, and probably yes, but I didn't pay any attention to that. After that, you know, it was what we were going to do about it.
But did you understand that what was on them?
Yeah, they made the demands. I heard they made some kind of demands. They didn't want as many, you know, they didn't want us they didn't want us to make Lenny McKinley a black school, pretty much so. They wanted to stay as it was. Those were the demand. No black pictures on the wall, no black anthem. We wanted the black anthem to be played after the Pledge of Allegiance. Those are some of the demands we wanted, and they didn't want that.
So were you surprised that Rick Warren was involved with that he did that, based on your knowledge of him up to that point? And if you were surprised or not surprised, why?
Well, I wasn't. Well, no, I didn't know Rick that Warren well. He played football with him, but I'd never taken a class with him or really engaged in any conversation with Rick Warren, other than football. That's the only thing I ever played with Rick Warren. I knew him because, like I said, he was on the football team, and I played that year, and we were one end, he was on the other end. But as far as conversating with him, I didn't. I didn't hang with him, didn't talk to him, so I don't know.
Okay. And did you see him after that incident?
No. I hear he never went back to Lenny McKinley, maybe once or twice, and he graduated from another school other than Lenny McKinley.
Okay. So let us move a little bit further into the year. We'll go to May 19th of 71. Did you attend the march from Lenny McKinley?
Yes, we did. We marched down Cleveland Avenue to Broad Street. We had people don't know this, from West High School, a guy named Malachi. He met us at Broad in Cleveland Avenue, and we marched up Broad Street to Franklin Park. There we were supposed to have ran across the people from East High School, but they didn't come out. They stayed in.
And were they not permitted to come out?
As far as I know, what happened, as far as, you know, you hear stuff, I wasn't there. I couldn't say yes, no. I just know they didn't come out. They had the windows open looking at us, but no one came out and joined us.
And what was the purpose of going to Franklin Park? What was happening
Well, we
there?
we had youthful ideas of changing the park to Malcolm X Park, which we now I'm thinking about it was awfully a youthful idea. We wanted to change it to Malcolm X Park. That was at the time was a predominantly black park. That's where we hung out at every Saturdays and Sundays. So we thought, hey, we can maybe get a name on it as Malcolm X Park, and that would be great, honoring Malcolm X.
And can you describe the rally that was happening there? What it was to commemorate
Malcolm X's birthday. Yeah.
So can you just state that?
Yeah, it was to commemorate. I think the word is Malcolm X's birthday. When we got there, I guess we had speeches and people talking and stuff like that. I don't remember all the details of it, but I myself and a lot of other people were there, and that's what it was. That's what it, the purpose of it was.
Okay, and was Charles Ross at that rally?
As far as I know, no. I don't recall him.
And can you talk about your memories of Charles Ross, though?
Okay, my memories of Charles Ross is absolutely none. I have no memories of Charles Ross other than when he got arrested. I didn't know where he came from because we had meetings and so forth, and he never was part of our meetings. He never led us on any meetings, never told us how to organize. My idea of Charles Ross, I didn't know where he came from. And it was two guys, John Whitaker and John Wells, who I thought maybe they knew him more so than I did. And over the years, I've talked to them about Dr. Ross, and they said they don't know where he come from. I guess he just was at came to Lynn McKinley at the wrong time, at the wrong place. And people had to put him as the leader of the group. They didn't believe the kids could organize. So they made him the leader of it. But no, he was not in any of our meetings. He never influenced us. This is something that the kids, as kids, we did ourselves.
Okay, and so shortly after the rally at Franklin Park, on May 24th of 71, did you attend the community meeting at Bethel AMU Church? And if you did, can you describe what that was about and what happened there?
Well, earlier that day, we were going to have a meeting. We had planned a protest because the white students had ran out on us the day before. We was going to have a rally. So the next day we were going to have a meeting. We were going to bring the red, black, and green flag to Lyndon McKinley. We was going to put it on the flagpole, say the black pledge, and then we were going to leave out. As we walked out the auditorium, they had riot cops and they came charging after us. And some of the kids went on the outside, ran different directions, and some people on the inside ran different directions. And just so happened, I was one of the few that didn't get outside, and I just closed the door, you know. And one of the teachers, I know his name, but I'm not going to mention it, opened up the doors, and the cops came inside. The policemen came inside, and mayhem started happening inside once they got inside. Now, what happened outside, I don't know. You can ask John Whitaker. He said he got his head busted by Billy Club. I don't know what happened outside. Only thing I know is what happened inside, because I never did get outside. But our purpose was just, we had two flagpoles in Lynn McKinley. We had one on the building, we had one in the middle of the schoolyard, and that's the one we were going to try to raise and put the red, black, and green flag on.
Okay, but can we backtrack a little bit to the meeting at the church?
Oh, okay. At the meeting at the church.
Yeah, yeah.
The things I understand, they had the safety director, police director. We had John Wells get up on the stage and lambast blast the parents for not supporting us and saying this is what he would do. And if you were kids, and at that point in time, we marched up to Lyndon McKinley. Reverend Dowdy led us up there. I think this was his name. Led us up there and. Anyway, I'm trying to let me think about this. we,
yeah, take your time.
Okay, we walked up to Lynn, we went up there to Lynn McKinley, and just so happened, getting up to Lynn McKinley, we couldn't get inside. No one knew how to get up on the roof and take the flag down, the American flag down. Only person knew that was me, because I had constantly gone to the library, and they had a little storage room in the back, and the teacher would let me go back there and read books. And I looked outside and saw that it led to the roof. So we climbed through one of the doors, went through the roof, got on top of the roof, about four of us, and took down the American flag and put the red, black, and green flag up. During that period of time, an incident took place. First of all, people wanted to burn the American flag, and I wouldn't let them burn the American flag. I mean, even though I was young, I still was an American. So I didn't let them burn the American flag. And number two, some people from the east side was trying to burn Lyndon McKinley. They had set up a music room full of music sheets, and they were trying to set it on fire. And as I was coming back down, I said, no, y'all not going to burn down Lyndon McKinley. I mean, what school are we going to go to? Y'all going to burn our school down. And I know the names of the people, but I won't mention their name again. And we went out and we put the red, black, and green flag up, and then about 100 cops, policemen were around, and they saw what we did, then they took it down later on that night. But we did put it up and said the pledge and went home.
And when you put the flag up, was that on the evening of the meeting at Bethel?
That was afterwards, because once the meeting was over, it was highly contested. People were speaking, and Wells got up there and spoke. John Wells got up there and spoke. And that's when we marched from the church up to Lyndon McKinley.
And at the meeting, there were parents. And students. Can you talk about who was there? And then can you talk about who specifically marched with you to the school?
It was parents. It was students. It was elected officials. It was the Reverend Dowdy, I think that's his name was, I'm not sure. And all of us marched up to the school. After we got through, some of the parents, but most of it was students, marched up to the school. We marched up Cleveland Avenue, walked to the school. 25th and Cleveland Avenue was filled with police cars and so forth. So when we get to the school, which is about two blocks away from 24th and Cleveland, no one knew how to get in. Like I said, I was the only person that knew how to get in there and get on top of the roof. And we got on there and we put up the red, black, and green flag. And like again, they wanted to burn the American flag, and I wouldn't let them burn the American flag.
So you were the person who actually literally physically switched the flags?
No, I was up on the roof. No, it was about four of us up on the roof. I was up on the roof too, but it was other people that pulled the flags down and stuff like that and put the American flag there.
And when you were up there, the four of you, and mm-hmm. you were working to make this happen, mm-hmm. what was going through your mind? How did you feel?
Proud, extremely proud. American red, black, and green flag up at Lyndon McKinley, extremely proud. But at the same time, I was sad too. Why should we have to do this? This is America. Why don't that flag represent us too? Why do we need to take down another flag to say that we're black? This is America. They should have had a flag to represent the African Americans, the blacks, the Latinos, everybody. This flag should represent everybody. This is our country too. As much as we say it is, and it's our country too. Because without our labor, without our work, it would not be a United States of America right now. I mean, they won't say it, but they owe us a whole lot. A whole lot. And that's the sad thing about it. And they want to keep us in this second grade citizen. No. This is the United States. Second Amendment gives us the pursuit of happiness. And we should be able to do whatever they do just as well as what they do.
Indeed. You mm-hmm. said that very beautifully. Mm-hmm. Thank you. So then the next day, when you got to school, first of all, was the red, black, and green flag still up?
No, they had taken it down that night. I think the janitor came up there and took it down that night.
Okay, and then there was an assembly that was called, I know that John Wells apparently was involved with that. Were you a part of that assembly? Were you at that assembly? And can you talk about why you all wanted to come together and what you talked about, and then what happened after that?
See, some of these things, some of the dates and times and places, as you get older, you forget. I wish you guys had access like 20 years ago or 30 years ago. It used to come. Right after that, we had prior assemblies all from February until May. We would walk out some, they would walk out on some. I don't know which one was which. You see, after the 25th, I don't know if we actually had a meeting after that period of time. Because we pretty much didn't go to school after that.
Okay, so then maybe we could just talk about the police raid itself. And if you could talk about what you remember right before the police came into the school, and also when they came in, describe what you saw.
What had happened is, I think you said May the 28th, May the 24th, right? 71. And well, when the police came in, they had their riot gear on, and they rushed us. Like I said, I was just getting ready to come out. And as I was coming out, they rushed toward the door. So what I did, I closed the door so that they couldn't get inside. So all the kids kind of scattered. So I was sitting by the door watching the police. And they was trying to get in the door, and I was just looking at them. So then I stepped away from the door, and one of the teachers inside opened up the door. And that's when they came in with their riot gear, telling us get to class and pushing people and telling us what to do and all this other stuff. And, you know, the weirdest thing was that they walked right past me. I never seen it. I was on one side of the hall, and they walked right past me. They never said anything to me, but they was trying to open up the door, and I'm sitting there watching them trying to open up the door, and I didn't open up the door. But when they rushed in, they just went right past me. They didn't do anything to me. But it was a guy next to me named Stanley Wilder. What's Stanley's name, John?
Wilder.
Stanley Wilder, and they picked him up and slammed him on the ground, and I heard he had to go to court for it and everything else. And they started pushing the students and, you know, using billy clubs and controlling the school, taking control of the school and everything like that. But they never, it was the weirdest thing, they never said anything to me or did anything to me. It was just kind of weird.
So is it fair to say that what you saw around you, though, was chaos?
Mayhem and chaos. Yes, it did. I say that right offhand. Chaos and mayhem.
How did you feel?
Again, terrible. Terrible. We were students. We was kids. Why did you need the police to control kids? Why do you need to have riot gear, billy clubs, helmets, and stuff like that for kids? So it was terrible, absolutely terrible.
Did you see Charles Ross or Wesley Greenfield, the custodian, be arrested?
No, I wasn't there when he got arrested. I heard about them. I didn't see it. Like I said, that's different perspective. Some people might have seen it. Some people, I didn't even know that Tom Brown had got arrested until this year. I wasn't there when he got arrested. Somebody told me he got arrested. I didn't even know that. So, like I say, if you on one side of the building and something else happened on the other side of the building, you wouldn't know about it.
Okay, so you, speaking of arrested, you talked a little bit about getting arrested yourself shortly after the police raid, so this was some days later. Yeah. Can you talk about why you were at the school on that particular day?
Well, we was coming.
What happened?
Well, we was coming. We had to take our finals and clean up our lockers and stuff like that. Senior finals and so forth. So I walked to the school, and I had a friend of mine. His name was Don Ballore. He was an artist, and he had drawn a picture of a black Jesus. And you know me being who I am, I taped it on the back of my jacket. At the time, they had something called wet look, and I taped it on my jacket, and I went to school. And as I'm going to school, school was, at that point in time, it was occupied by the police. All it was police presence in the building, police presence out. So I'm walking up Duxbury, And as I'm walking up Duxbury, the cops, the policeman called me a nigga. Look at that little black nigga walking with this. I had a black beret hat on, a black Jesus on the back. And I didn't cuss at the time, so I just gave him the finger. And I walked inside the building, and I was getting ready to clean out my locker. And I think it was because, I hate to say this, I'm going to have to say something. I think I shouldn't say this, but one of the white teachers walked me to my locker. And I was talking to her, but I had known her. She was a gym teacher. I'd known her for 3 or 4 years. And the cops came out there, and he saw me talking to her. He left. The next thing I know, 3 or 4 cops came back, and they arrested me. And supposedly for trespass. Disorderly conduct. That's what it was, disorderly conduct. And my mother had told me, if you get arrested, you're gonna stay in jail. You're gonna stay in there. So I had to stay in jail for about a week and a half or something like that before my trial date. I had two of my friends down below again, and Philip Crockett come up there, and they had walked to school with me, and they said that. So anyway, the cop got on the stand, said, "I said piss on you," which is something that we don't even say. And you understand the language, and they testified that. They testified that I didn't say anything. I just gave him the finger, and. Anyway, the judge, he convicted me, gave me suspended sentence, told me to write something about the rights of people and stuff like that, and I wouldn't do it. My sister, who was a journalism major, who graduated from Ohio State and journalism major, she wanted to write it, and I told her no. And another friend of mine, sister who was going to Ohio State, she wanted to write it for me, and I told them no, because I know I was innocent. I knew that I didn't do what the cops said I did. I knew I was unjustly incarcerated. So later on, I got arrested again. They gave me 15 more days for the incident. And I was on.
So you were arrested again for the same incident?
Yeah. Well, I was supposed to write that paper. When I didn't write the paper, got arrested again. And so the sentences that he had suspended, he reimposed them.
And how would you say, given who you were before that, and the way you saw the world before that, how did that affect you? That whole experience of, you know, everything from the time that the cops made the comment to you to the point when the judge reimposed the rest of that suspended sentence. Mm-hmm.
This is the funniest thing I'm going to say. I had read, you know, George Jackson's book, Soul Dad, and you feel like you are a political prisoner. That's what it was, more so of a political prisoner than anything else. Because I knew I was unjustly done, so I felt more like a political prison. You know, this is stuff you got to go through for the civil rights movements. You know, the Freedom Riders had to stay in prisons and stuff like that, and in jails and stuff like that. I'd read how they was treated and things like that, and I felt in some way like that. It was just something that you had to suffer.
So, and that was when you were taking exams. Mm. So basically from the time of the police raid until the exam period, was the school shut down? What was the rest of the school year like after that, after the raid?
Well, it started back in February when he threw that paper overboard. We pretty much didn't go to school regular since that period of time. I mean, we would have assemblies, people would walk out. The whites walked out a couple of assemblies we had. So when they would have another assembly, we would walk out. I don't think from February, the moment Rick Warren threw that paper overboard, over the balcony, that we went to school regular from that point on. I don't remember us going. We might show up a day. White kids would be out. Next time we would be out, and it was consistent. It was no, continually going to school.
So then it's fair to say there was more division.
More divisions, absolutely more division.
Now, can you talk about how the totality of your experience at Lyndon McKinley, everything that happened? How did that affect your path after high school?
Yeah, well, it affected my path a lot of ways, you know. One of the things was I wasn't taking any crap from people. I got fired from a lot of jobs because I wouldn't laugh and smile. You know, I wasn't gonna be no head bobber. That's what they, I couldn't be was a head bobber when people say silly stuff or say jokes and stuff, you know. I had a reputation as being, you know, what's the term? Reputation as, I think a lot of people kind of didn't fear me because I wouldn't smile and laugh. You know, I wasn't the kind of guy to go out and talk to you. And you see something stupid, and I'm gonna laugh and joke and all this other stuff. I wasn't gonna be a head bobber. I wasn't gonna be no Uncle Tom. I wasn't gonna be any of those things. And you know, we're working in a society. You know, sometimes you got to laugh and joke. Yeah, but I never done that. So sometimes I would just get fired because they just didn't like my attitude. They just didn't like the way I presented myself, and it affected me for years.
So. Do you feel like you paid a price for not going along with the program?
You could say that, but I think it was just that. It's just, like I said, it was suffering. I mean, look at the other guys, you know, Representative Lewis and all of them guys and all the people, Malcolm X and Martin Luther King, all them guys, they suffered their ultimate prices. The ultimate price, those are the guys that really should be the heroes, you know, and even in South Africa, Mandela, them guys suffered way more than the little things that I went through. Those are the real heroes, not me. Oh no, you know, the guys, you know, these guys, Muhammad Ali suffered all that 2 or 3 years of not being able to use his fist to make money, and people like that, those are the heroes. Me, I just suffered 15 days in jail, you know, I'm not even close to compared to them guys, but they were my idols.
Well, and I'm not trying to compare, but I'm saying you're telling me that your sense is that you lost jobs.
Yeah.
You lost work, which is your livelihood, because you wouldn't play a role. That's all I'm getting at.
Yeah, absolutely. But you know, a job is just like you lose one job, get another job. It ain't never affected me. I went to Ohio State, graduated. It didn't affect me. I mean, that period of time it did. So, no.
And can you talk about what did you study at Ohio State?
Marketing, business, right here in Hagerty Hall. I was here for years. I took classes probably every building here. Started off as a freshman, and by the time I graduated, they thought I was a professor. So yeah, okay. I had some pretty inspirational people. I had Dr. Gooks, who was my economic professor. He taught us a lot. I don't know if you ever heard of Cecil Gooks. People know him. He was here for years. And I had quite a few people that you know, talked to me and tried to inspire me. So.
Do you feel like did your experience at Lyndon McKinley affect you at Ohio State at all?
No. Only thing it affected me was by going to Lyndon McKinley, only thing where it affected me, I needed to probably, no, I'm not going to say that. No, it didn't. No. Like I said, I wasn't a head bobber. I just was not a head bobber. I wasn't a guy that was going to go along just to get along. You know, that's one of the things it did for me. I'm not laughing, not joking. If something ain't right, I'm not laughing and joking about it. That's me.
Okay, so I want to ask you also, I want to bring you to today and just ask your thoughts on the demonstrations for racial and social justice and against police brutality. Against racial violence that are happening now in the United States. What are your thoughts when you see that? And also, can you talk a little bit about your outlook on America's political future?
Well, my thing is this. Again, I think America could be the greatest country in the world if it just lived up to its true meaning, as Dr. Martin Luther King said. And, you know, it has everything to be a great country. But as long as this systemic racism is still existing, we need to be out there protesting. I'm trying to figure out why 50 years later they just now picking it up. That's the question. But then somebody said they brought crack into our community, and that quenched a lot of protesting. But I'm trying to figure out why did it take them 50 years later, or years later. This should have been ongoing. It should never stop. And I hope it doesn't stop until we get rid of it. I hope it never stop. Don't just do it this year and next year and stop. It should be an ongoing thing to all systemic racism has gotten rid of in America. Because this country doesn't belong to no one. This country belongs to the people who are here. It belongs to the immigrants who come here. It belongs to the African American. It belongs to the Latino. It belongs to the whites. This is our country. It's not just one person country. And until we get rid of this, when everybody is treated equally, then it should continue. Protesting should continue. Police cannot take advantage of people just because they're a different color. They have to understand we're American just like them. And some of these people just got here. We was here, our parents and foreparents was here before they even got here. And they trying to make decisions on us, telling us what to do and how to do it. They should first give them an education into American culture. The suffering that people have to go through to get to the position that we're going to. And this is something that should every immigrant. They're taking advantage of stuff that we went through, our protesting, our things like that. The marching that we did and the suffering that our people suffered, the lynching that we had to go through. All of this have to be brought out and let people know this is why America is where it is today. This is what America is today because some people suffer. Some people said, no, we're not going to take this. And this should continue from here on out until, like I said, until every American, until they get rid of systemic racism. It's in all our culture. It's all part of our business. It's part of our lives. A lot of people don't understand that. They think, oh, I can't see it. Oh, yeah, of course you can't see it because you're on the other end of the cards. But if you was on our end, you could see what we've experienced. And I was reading one of the reports. He said something like, you know, to be a black in American and be conscious of being black is a continual rage. I think Langston Hughes said that, something like that. You constantly got rage when you look at stuff and you see stuff. You know, you see black communities. Yeah, we got a lot of stuff going on in black communities, but a lot of it's just being pushed in the area. Why do we have to live in a certain area? Why can't we live anywhere we want to live at? It's because of systemic racism. Again, they won't sell you houses, they won't give you jobs, all of this other kind of stuff. This got to be, it has to come to an end. And until it comes to an end, yeah, they should continue protesting. They continue marching. They should continue standing up on social media or whatever they're doing nowadays. They should continue. They should continue to its end. And once it ends, America would be the greatest country again in the world. And what I'm looking at now, I'm just waiting to see how it's going to turn out. I've tried and did my part. I'm just seeing what the kids are going to do. And we will see. But again, I say it again, America can be the greatest country in the world. They keep saying that we are the greatest country. No, not yet. Not till we get rid of racism and systemic racism. But if it does, it will be the greatest country in the world.